Who says you can't? You do. By Daniel Shidiak. Chapter 40. Shaping your destiny. Mega state, 7-day challenge. Mega state is equal to mental plus verbal plus physical. Having the ability to quickly and intelligently change the way you feel in times of emotional challenges is critical on the road to achievement. It's time for us to raise the bar and take enormous action. The following tasks are things you are going to apply to your daily lives. So saying you don't have the time is unacceptable. Remember, you signed the contract at the beginning of the book and said you were ready for change. If you do not want to change, act, then close the book and pack it up. You cannot be helped unless you are willing to help yourself. If you want to excel, then make it happen. Look at yourself in the mirror and repeat this 10 times before you start each day for the next 7 days. Make sure you get very vocal, emotional, physical, and forceful until it gets you into a complete mega state of certainty. I am in control of shaping my whole life through my state of mind, the emotions I choose, and the actions I take every day. No matter what challenges I am faced with in these next 7 days, my spirit will display and direct my strength to my success. It will empower me to do it forever. I can do anything I want in my life. By doing this every morning for the next 7 days, you will prove your commitment to yourself. It makes what you are doing concrete and helps condition your state immediately. All people with extraordinary lives are able to change their state in an instant. That is the advantage they have over the masses. What is worth more than your life? Question mark. What are you willing to do to enhance it? Are you really committed to changing your course of direction forever? Is your truth telling that you are doing enough as it is? It does not matter how much you are doing toward empowering your life, it's still not enough. The moment you think you have done enough is the moment you stop working, going. Task 1. Commanding focus. Since belief is all important, it behooves you to guard your thoughts, and as your beliefs will be shaped to a very great extent by the things you observe and think about it. It is important that you should command your attention versus the battles. Requirement: monitor your thoughts and redirect them intelligently. Duration: day 1, 2, and 3. Description: you have already been implementing great changes with the previous task, but now we are stepping it up. When you start thinking of something that makes you feel down, worried, or stressed, you know what it is. It's only because of your choice of focus, and it must be corrected immediately. You must look at the effect that every thought is having on your success. Once you look at the effects of your thoughts rather than just thinking them, you jump off the automatic wheel and you are able to enhance your life. Being aware of the power of your thoughts is absolutely crucial for attaining happiness and gaining that you set out for. Only by doing this are you able to begin forming the mindset of the most successful people in history. Don't deliberate about the disempowering thoughts too much. Just block them out with as much power as you possibly can and replace them with something that you love. something that makes you happy, or something that would put you in a state of excitement or fulfillment. A projection of a desired vision you have put in place for yourself, or something that you really appreciate, is a great way to shift your focus and emotion immediately. Even if you feel that you should not, it does not matter. You must. If there is a secret to true fulfillment and achievement, it's being able to take control of your mind. I don't care what you have to do to get that thought out of your head. You must do it. Scream at yourself, or forcefully let yourself know that thought is not going to take control over your life anymore, and repeat the new thoughts over and over. One day my auntie thought I was crazy because she heard me screaming from outside my house. She said it sounded like a lion that had not eaten in a week. Quite a funny comparison, I thought, because that's how hungry I felt for my success. Good aggression is different from anger. Don't be mistaken. It's fine to get forceful with yourself, and is necessary in some challenging situations. No matter what it is or how challenging it may seem, you have to fight. Keep repeating that it's going to be okay, that it's all in your mind, and that you have full control of yourself at all times. There is always another way of looking at something. You choose the way you feel through your choice of thoughts. Tell your mind that you are now in control and you are not going to let it wander. To determine if a thought is having a detrimental effect on your life, you must examine the feeling you get from it. You must have that army always ready at the entrance of your mind. For example, if you are thinking, "I can't make it," you will quickly repeat, "I can make it. I can make it," over and over with more force. This is training your mind. And what goes on in your mind determines that the outcomes you get in life. You must maintain focus on your new direction. Even after a week, you will notice that disempowering thoughts diminish just by being aware of them. Proper attention does not just miraculously appear. It needs to be directed and deliberately commanded with intensity. Task 2. Shift vocabulary and body. A helping word to one in trouble is often like a switch on a railroad track, an inch between wreck and smooth, rolling prosperity. Henry Ward Beecher. Requirement: take control over the words you say and your body language. Duration: day 4, 5 and 6. Description: we previously covered the importance that your language has on your life. Now it's time to monitor and course correct for the empowering options. Go back to the list of options in the bubble action section, page 143, and use that as a guide. For these 3 days, there are to be no negative connotations or limiting words whatsoever. Speak with confidence and enthusiasm. Every time you say, "can't possible," "I am drained," or "too hard," you are to correct yourself immediately. Even by staying conscious of this, you will break your old patterns and the emotions you experience throughout your day. You will make your day surprisingly better just by doing this exercise. When people complain to you, do not join in. The results you see from this are actually going to make you laugh after the week is over. You will be wondering why you ever chose to save your life with your previous discussions. Avoid the news on TV, in newspaper, or anything else that can implant negative thoughts in your mind during this exercise. This way, you will not be able to talk to others about these emotionally draining topics unless you are using it to benefit yourself or others. It will force you to come up with intelligent things to discuss, an important aspect to living a happy life. This also goes for the way in which you are going to hold your body in the next 3 days. When you're humble yet confident, you become a powerhouse. Don't be egotistical or walk around like you have a stick up your backside, because it may just have the opposite effect on what you want to achieve. It's not brain surgery to figure out how to stand confidently. Unless you are aware of your actions, you will never achieve or will be fulfilled. Take as much physical action as you can toward one of your wants on your life list, emails, phone calls, browsing the internet for information, and speaking to people are all taking action. It will build up. Task 3. Have fun with faith. Don't wait for experience. Create your experience. Requirement. Take the leap of faith and do something that you have never done before. Duration. Day 7. Description. Are you ready to explore? This is the task where you turn your fear into excitement and explore your ability to enrich your life experience. This exercise is so important to every part of your life that it absolutely must be completed. Do something that you have always wanted to do, or think of something new. Bungee jump, skydive, ice skate, go to an improv or cooking class, drive a go-kart, paint, talk to that person at the office or your coffee shop who seems cool, submit a short story to publication, go to gym, rock climb, or do whatever you can think of. If you are 65 years old and you think you are too old to go paint wall shooting, then think again. I was up against one such player the last time I went. Let's say, I got my butt kicked. That senior could shoot, not to mention the team of girls digging into me as well. My point is that there are no excuses, only fear. But that fear on the self for one day and do something that electrifies your spirit, no matter what it is. If it's pushing the boundaries for you, then do it. We get so caught up in routine that we forget to live. We experience the same emotions day in and day out. In order to create happiness, you must stay excited and have something to look forward to. Set this challenge up, but more important, enjoy it. This is the end of page number 174. Now started chapter 15 of this book. Quality-driven success. Educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all. Aristotle. Too many people have become misled by the concept of achievement and the word success. We have proved so many times throughout history that the view of success that so many people take on board is a myth. It was February 2010 when a close friend rang me up to tell me that famous fashion designer Alexander McQueen had hanged himself in his apartment. But he had all this money and all this fame, so why would he commit suicide? He is just one of many great achievers who have taken their life. Edwin Armstrong, inventor of FM radio in 1954. Pierre Barry Gouvelle, former French Prime Minister in 1993. Kurt Cobain, singer, songwriter and Nirvana co-founder in 1994. And Robin Williams, actor and comedian, in 2014, all ended their own lives. The list goes on, not to mention how many top actors, athletes, and artists suffer from drug abuse and emotional torment. On the other hand, there are many who have it all in life, fulfillment and great achievements. What's the difference between the two? Some search for a feeling of success only through their to their achievements. The other acknowledge that success is in who they are and how they live their life. not in what they have. The truth is, we can continue to achieve in our life and still be unfulfilled. You might want to be successful in raising a child, in fitness, in your finances, in your relationship with others, in one particular area of your life, or in all of them. I just want you to understand that success does not exist in anything outside of you and should never be looked at as a thing you must chase. Success does not lie in a Ferrari, a mansion, or any of the achievements mentioned above. Just like any purchase or singular desire you have wanted in your life, the feeling does not last. All people who base their definition of success or external desires eventually ask themselves, is that it? What now? I know that's happened to you in the past with something, and you should understand that it will never change. It may have been the new watch, the handbag, the vacation, or the new car. Regardless of what it was, there came a time when you were once again at a standstill. You need depth and meaning in your life. True success is to discover the enormous power you have within, who you are, and the attitude you take out to life every day. Once you have grasped this, everything else will flow. Success must come well before obtaining those external wants. Once you attain real success first and begin to live a great life, the rest becomes the cherries on top of a beautiful made cake. If the cherries are taken away for whatsoever reason, it won't really make much difference because the cake is already complete. It's extremely important to realize that it's success that actually gets what you want, not the other way around. When one is not at peace, nothing makes sense. People have based success on money for many years. In recent times, success has taken on a whole new meaning as more people are striving to be genuinely successful and focusing on abundance, surrounded by so much external pressure and demand by fast-moving societies. We are now striving for quality success. This is a balance between an inner peace and a constant self-growth that leads to achievement in all areas of life. Obviously, the degree of achievement is based on an individual's particular wants. Time does not stand still, so we always aspire to go to the next level in our lives. Anchoring our success to important qualities will prevent going around in circles just waiting to achieve fulfillment. Don't be mistaken. Just because someone is a great achiever does not mean they are successful. In essence, success equals fulfillment, that deep understanding of ourselves. We all seek different dreams, but everyone strives for a balance. This is why I have worked to discover and find the qualities that must give and drive success, QDS. QDS is the process of eliminating negativity from within and hence from your surroundings right now. So you are able to attract and create more intelligent. If we allow the term success to drive the quality of our life, then we may become misled along the way and continue to work against what will really fulfill us. Never let it be the notion of success that enhances the quality of your life. Rather, let it be the qualities of your life that enhance success. It's like trying to build a state-of-the-art house on a poor foundation. It will never be stable, but more important, it will never be state-of-the-art. Those qualities are the great foundation. When challenges arise on your journey, your strong foundation will prove that you can resist the pressure. I used these qualities to attract the most marvelous experience, discover hidden knowledge, strengthen persistence, and achieve at a greater level. This stuff is powerful. What's great about these qualities is that all of us have them now. accessible and ready to use. Don't be someone who blindly walks around life, believing they have to get patience, love, strength or the truth. The sudden reality is that you have all the qualities you have been searching for. They have always been within you. Whether you choose to use them or not is up to you. First, love, the ultimate quality. A coward is incapable of exhibiting love. It is the prerogative of the brave. Mahatma Gandhi. They say love comes in many forms. They also say that love can drive us crazy. Is it really love that does those things, or are we tarnishing the reputation of divine emotion? Are we undermining love and giving it unnecessary associations? I believe love comes in only one form, in the purest state. I had someone refer to love as coming in many different forms. When they told a story of a man who became so obsessed with his ex-girlfriend that he stalked her for 3 years. Love does not drive these actions. Jealousy, greed, hatred or vengefulness should never be mistaken for the almighty love. For true love opposes such things. Love does not drive us crazy, our inner demons battling it for. Love is the primary quality that can set us free from that feeling of emptiness. I am speaking of a love so pure, it is not restricted by what we see with our eyes, but is a feeling we attain from within, like the love some have for their mother, pet, child, husband or life itself. That love is far beyond our eyes. Your dog may be the ugliest mutt to you, some, but the love you have for it is not restricted by its outward appearance. True love asks nothing but to fulfill itself. You alone can fulfill yourself with that love that lies eagerly within you. It will appear, but we ignore it on so many occasions. Love is the true guide in life and the only one to be served. If we do things out of pure intent, love will surely answer. Through love, your dreams become real, and every day life will show itself in the most beautiful way it knows how. It takes the cloth from your eyes and allows you to see the world in its truest essence. You align yourself with the world and everything in it, which is the basis of your dreams coming true. One man who had much controversy surrounding him, but who I believe demonstrated much love that went unnoticed, was Michael Jackson. A particular statement of his that I thought was truth in essence was, "Let us dream of tomorrow, where we can truly love from the soul and know love as the ultimate truth at the heart of all creation." Regardless of perception or judgment of this man, that saying is undeniably true. The great know that greatness is love. Once you experience true love in your heart, you dedicate your life to sowing the earth what you have discovered. All the important aspects for achieving fulfillment stem from love. My plan is to cover some of the main ones that have a direct impact on obtaining that goal. Love is like the seed of a plant. The seed is already planted within us. It is then fed by water and sunlight, which are your experiences and time to act. The two must correlate. In order to be fed, the seed must be ready for it. Correct. The root then shoots out to the world and is exposed. It begins to blossom with all the effects of love, inner peace, patience, respect and appreciation, to name a few. Its roots grow far and wide until they eventually intertwine with other plants. We all have that seeds, and it's just waiting to be fed. Love by its very nature creates, and we are no exception. All men in history who have accomplished great things have used love as their driving force. It's the true essence of your being that will make you go well past your previous limitations and achieve things you once thought impossible. When love takes over your life, buckle up and get ready for a ride beyond your wildest dreams. This love is so great that it is reflected in everyone and everything. With love, your intention is to be the best person you know how and treat everyone and everything with the same respect and love. That's the secret to fulfillment. Life without love is like a tree without blossoms or fruit. Kahlil Gibran. Greatness also stems from love. In fact, everyone is great right now, but most are unaware of it. Loving yourself is an essential part of success. If you don't love yourself, you can never trust yourself to gain success. Would you really trust someone with your life that you did not love? Well, if you don't love yourself deep down and impress it on a daily basis, how can you trust yourself to get what you want? There is a difference between loving who you really are and loving who you pretend to be. Loving yourself is not about putting yourself above anyone else. Rather, a true self-love equalizes you with the world. You are able to understand yourself more and it allows you to better understand others. We have been conditioned to believe that loving ourselves is egotistical, but it's not loving ourselves that actually displays ego, because we as God out of our life. If you truly love yourself, E for S, G for God, O for out of your life. If you truly love yourself, you won't allow yourself to go out your claimed morals. You would acknowledge that others' growth is your growth and vice versa. In saying this, you can't really help anyone until you help yourself first. While helping yourself, you will be helping them. Contributing your true self is far better and far greater than materialistic help. We must not judge people on their appearance, religious status, or environment. We are all human and have an equally important role to play. If you commit to those limiting actions, you are only tarnishing a relationship with yourself, and it will never be the means to gain true success. When you treat others with respect, the respect you have for yourself grows. It's like when we meet someone who backs the same sports team or has the same cultural background. There is an instant bond and respect. We gain a success of belonging from that person and will immediately get into conversation, maybe share a laugh or two. There's a feeling of camaraderie that seem to arise. Imagine considering mankind as being on the same team. Picture the sense of belonging now and the rapport you will be able to build with others. Picture the difference in attitude and your approach toward those you come into contact with. Everything you do to others, you are equally doing to yourself. That is the law of life. No one escapes. My way of dealing with others is quite simple. I always take notice that they have the potential to love, were created by love, and I am convinced they are a great pupil deep down. I choose not to see what others see, and it greatly affects my experience with pupil. By doing this, they will feel your genuine approach and lack of ego. This method unconsciously faces others to react in a similar way. That's truly acting out of love, and it is reflected in everything and everyone around you. We are in this together. It's called networking. But remember, no one wants to help those who are not willing to help themselves. So do things out of love and good intentions, and there will always be being around, willing to lend a hand. Be is greater than me. But the change must start with you. Look at the mirror and tell yourself how much you love the person you see, regardless of what you have been through. It might seem stupid at the beginning, but that's only because social norms and other unfulfilled people have influenced your beliefs. Look at what this person in the mirror has been through, yet they are still here to face the music. That's something to love and respect, because it shows strength and a determination to never give up. If you want to give love and be loved, you must love yourself first. When you feel love on the inside, you will see love on the outside. You are loved. It is better to start loving yourself than to wait around for someone else to do it for you. Pure love is freedom. Eventually, you will come to understand that love heals everything and love is all there is. Gary Zukav. Freedom begins with the power that comes from understanding that you control your life. It is the absolute condition that you choose the way you feel, and hence the way you live in, structured by freedom of choice. We have been socially programmed to believe that our freedom is based on outside events. In other words, we must wait for things to make us happy on the outside to complete our inner self. In order to experience true freedom in your life, you must realize that your perception of the outside world is nothing more than a mirror reflection of the internal self that you create. How you feel is what you see. The inside must change first in order for the outside to be seen in happiness at a deeper level. When we change our perception of the outside, it really does change what happens on the outside. We choose to create our physical, mental and verbal actions every day. Without realizing it, we make them stronger by repetition. Mostly, we are oblivious to the fact that we are creating our lives under such slavery. Our freedom is not dependent on a job, a vacation, or any other person. We may change a job or decide to go on a trip, but essentially it is the freedom that was discovered first that allows us to do those things. Attaining freedom by choice is the only way to discover fulfillment. If you are looking for the material world to free you, then you will never find it. Eternal freedom stems from pure love of oneself. A love so strong that it trusts you to feed your intuition, all the while projecting that same love out to the world. Cold and wet nights seems to be appreciated just as much as warm ones. Challenges are seen as life's growth. Faith in yourself blossoms, and you finally witness the beauty that surrounds you. You choose to be free or not every day. What is it about love that makes it so fascinating? Could it be its ability to transcend the earthly concept of life? The quality of knowing your truth. Since love and not understanding is the starting point, for the journey of self-truth, all who wish to walk it can take the first step. As I was cleaning the mirrors at a boxing gym I once worked at, something dawned on me. Looking at them from a distance, I was not able to tell whether they were dirty or not. The closer I looked, the more unclean they became. The only way I was able to clean the mirror was by taking a closer look, with my reflection staring back at me. I wondered how could use this principle in my life. We don't notice our truth or the uncleanliness we surrounded ourselves with unless we decide to take a closer look. From a distance, we can be fooled into thinking that we are following our heart and need no improvement, but dare to take a closer look and the real answers begin to appear. In order to be truly happy and obtain what we desire, we must be honest with ourselves. Why do we undermine our ability to achieve happiness? So often we ignore what we now will ultimately benefit our life. I believe that we all have a sound understanding of our truthful side when it's time to make a decision, but it may be the easier option to lie to ourselves. Initially, this might seem like the case, but the truth has an uncanny way of catching up to us, does not it? Someone named Chris asked me a challenging question on this topic. He said, if the ultimate truth is love, that inner voice, and we are all able to recognize it, we are all able to recognize it. What about a terrorist? Truth. Their truth is to kill people. This was how the conversation went on. Me, does a terrorist love something? It can be his mother, sister, pet or anything. Chris, well, I guess he would. Yeah. Me, okay. So he knows that love feels good, right? Chris says, yes. Me, so what would happen if someone came up and killed that something that he loved? How would that make him feel? Because being human, I would say it would feel like hell. Me, okay, so the terrorist is able to distinguish that love feels good and having something killed feels rotten. Because I see where you are going with this. Me, yes or no? Because yes. Well, that's the truth right there, isn't it? When a terrorist kills someone who he knows is loved by somebody else, it's for greed, ill power or selfish satisfaction. It's not the truth. He is feeding his lies and he knows it. He will never find fulfillment doing such an act because he is separating himself from his true essence. Humans have a fundamental tendency toward truth. Call it common sense, conscious ability, reasoning, it does not matter. We are all able to distinguish between a loving act and a hateful one. We are built with love, that ultimate truth, and love will question every decision we make. Lying to yourself does not hide the truth, so you can bet your life that it will always come and display itself. We don't have a very high tolerance for psychological dissonance of any kind. Self-deception can have terrible consequences for a person's experience of their conscience, even in a person with a not-so-advanced conscience. A man may imagine things that are false, but he can only understand things that are true. But if the things be false, the apprehension of them is not understanding. Isaac Newton. The greatest indication of knowing our truth is listening to that deep voice within that tells us what is correct. It's that same voice that tells you one way with make you ultimately happy, while the other path will only bring you short-term satisfaction. Some call it the heart, and science is proving now more than ever the connection between emotional and psychological changes in our body. Dr. Deepak Chopra has a deep understanding of how these two correlate and the vast impact they have on our lives. I never realized how crucial the saying, follow your heart, is in shaping our destiny. The problem is we rarely listen to it. Realistically, we can ask as many questions as we want to as many people as we need until we get the answer we desire. Surprisingly enough, we always know the truth is different We just occasionally think that feeding a lie will fulfill us, but it does not. A lie stands on one leg, truth on two. Benjamin Franklin. We also judge ourselves on those decisions we choose to make. We are all our own judge and deciders on where we go in life. Another God-given gift we all have. We are able to distinguish between a lie and the truth. But instead of taking action, we submit again to what we know is creating suffering. This continues to create a life we don't want to live. Don't we judge ourselves? We lie to ourselves and are forced to visit that inner courtroom 1,000 times over with the same fault. Most people will play both parts and won't fight for their truth. Every time, even though they are able to acknowledge it, they are not just in their judging. They do things that they know are against their moral laws or who they really are. The more they lose in their courtroom, the harder it is to believe they can win the next trial. They live a life of losing their truth to lies and are never happy. We must be fair and just judges. If you have a belief that causes you to act in a certain way toward yourself, life, the environment or others, I urge you to ask this one question. Does this belief or decision ultimately help me demonstrate more love to myself and everyone and everything around me? If the answer is no, then it is not worthy to hold up in the courtroom of truth. No one escapes this law of life. It's supreme important to refer back to love in your belief. And I did even suggest questioning it against the teachings in this book. I don't want you to go just believe this because I have said so. I want you to reason with your own truth. Acknowledge that your truth has always and will always hold love as a pinnacle of your fulfillment. If you make decisions that don't display love, especially for yourself, then life will force you to. And at times, it has no mercy in the length it will go to wake you up. I am sure we can all relate to that at one stage in our life. All the answers you seek are within. They have never ceased to exist. You must be willing to reason with yourself in order to bring out the truth. As the famous poet Khalil Gibran says so superbly in his masterpiece, The Prophet, God rests in reason. God moves in passion, and since you are a breath in God's spell and a leaf in God's forest, you too should rest in reason and move in passion. I must say, I truly find peace, not just in knowing I have the ability to reason with myself, but in putting it into practice. The only way to know a wise person, a great teacher of the truth, or an enlightened soul is if they speak of a love for all as the ultimate truth. If they don't teach you this, you are sadly being lied to. It's one thing being able to distinguish between your truth and your lie. Yet it's vastly different when it's time to act. Mastering this next quality is the key to experiencing a joy most people only dream about having. Thank you very much for listening. This is the end. Chapter 15, page 187. Who says you can't? You do. Third, feeding your truth is a quality for everlasting happiness. There are only two mistakes one can make along the way to truth. First, not going all the way. And second, not starting. The Buddha. When we feed something, it goes for some fear, sadness, lack of direction and unhappiness have become daily indulgence. Every time you make a decision or commit an act that is against your truth, love, kindness, happiness, giving patience, it sabotages the relationship you have with yourself. Is it any wonder that so many people don't know what they want or which direction to take. On the other hand, when you feed your truth, it will go to a size you never imagined possible. In your truth also lies fulfillment. When we begin to feed that truth, our happiness gets fuller, and in it is found inner peace. There is no limit to the growth. It's a never-ending supply, because you are supplying it. You are the hand that feeds you, so you can always rely on yourself. However, if your hand is always reaching out to be fed by an external supply, that growth can stop at any time. Those people, money and situations may not last forever. The more you grow, the more your supply of truth grows. I am so glad I trained myself to feed my truth, because it's definitely the reason you are reading this. If I had not, I would never have been able to discover what I am great at. I have spoken to excellent achievers, but more important, those who are successful. And they all have the same thing to say. They begin listening to and acting on that voice deep inside. Not only for major decisions that had to be made, but also for the smallest acts of everyday life. There is a distinguishable truth in every moment, opportunity, or experience. If you are willing to reason with yourself, you will be able to clearly identify it, and more important, act on it. We must really start listening to that intelligent and wise voice within. If brushing it off has become a way of life, you must change immediately. Here is one example of how I conditioned myself to feed my truth. We all know what a garbage bin is used for, so we are able to distinguish that the bin is there to serve that purpose and throw garbage in. Common sense reminded me of this my whole life, but I chose to ignore it on so many occasions. The difference now was that I begin to amplify my truth, common sense, which clearly told me to throw my trash in a bin. With throwing something on the ground when I knew there was a better alternative was disrespectful, and I guess if we want respect, we must give respect. By taking my truth into consideration and actually listening to it, I was able to see the important role it played in my own life. This change in action taught me a few other things. One of them was that I was able to commit to doing something that I actually wanted to do. I feared that deep voice, and it instantly created new emotions. Follow your heart, but be quiet for a while first. Ask questions, then feel the answer. Learn to trust your heart, Anand. This simple change in behavior will train you to have patience when something like a garbage bin is not accessible right away. You don't do something that is against what you really know you should do just to obtain some short-term satisfaction. Can you see how this could benefit us in reaching our great visions? It might seem very insignificant, but this is what allows you to actually acknowledge that you have the power to think, act, and create for yourself. It allows you to create your own happiness, which in turn helps you to respect more of your decisions. More important, it proves that the feeling of fulfillment does exist, even when you make a decision that is extremely hard at the time. You will never regret it if it's aligned with your truth. When you believe something enough, you live by it. We always force ourselves to feel down when we do something that is against our truth. But how often do we recognize or acknowledge when we do something great? to condition a great and rewarding feeling when acting on that conscious voice is the ultimate advantage in life. Remember, it starts with the small things, because that's what gets the ball rolling. If you don't have the energy to do the small task, how are you ever going to reach your peak in performance or get the most out of life? When you make the decision to feed your truth, don't dither about it. Make sure you create the energy if you must, and do it with great intention. A smoker is a perfect example. When I ask people about their smoking habit, they say, "But I want to smoke." Nearly every time I ask if they were in an ideal world and could be free from smoking, would they? I get the answer, "Yes, of course." The truth is the voice that tells them to give it up, and they know it. That voice is always speaking, and you know when it does. Are you going to mess up along the way? Of course, you are human. In life, we may not make all the best decisions, but we are not meant to. If we did, we would never know growth. The seeker after truth should be humble, humbler than the dust. Only then, and not till then, will he have a glimpse of truth. In the march toward truth, anger, selfishness, hatred, etc., naturally give way, for otherwise truth would be impossible to attain. Mahatma Gandhi. A social term for acting on our truth is integrity. In Western ethics, integrity is regarded as the quality of having an intuitive sense of honesty and truthfulness in regard to the motivations for one's actions, and it can be regarded as the opposite of hypocrisy. The word integrity stems from the Latin adjective integer, whole, complete. In this context, integrity is the inner sense of wholeness, deriving from qualities such as honesty and consistency of character. As such, one may judge that others have integrity to the extent that one judges whether they behave according to the values, beliefs, and principles they claim to hold. Just really listen to yourself, then act on it. That's all it takes. Mahatma Gandhi summed up our inner voice best. There come to us moments in life when about something we need no proof from without. A little voice within us tells us, "You are on the right track. Move neither to your left or nor right, but keep to the straight and narrow way." There are moments in your life when you must act. Even though you cannot carry your best friends with you, the still small voice within you must always be the final arbiter when there is a conflict of duty. Having made a ceaseless effort to attain self-purification, I have developed some little capacity to hear correctly and clearly the still small voice within. I lost my usefulness the moment I stifled the still small voice within. Penances with me are no mechanical acts. They are done in obedience to the inner voice, excerpt from Mahatma, a golden treasure of wisdom, thoughts, and glimpses of life. 4. Quality of forgiveness. Don't live in regret. You think you look strong because you can hold on, but strength lies in letting go. Ellen Mandela. You can spend your whole life hanging on to what could or should have been, but you can't go back in time. When we read a novel, we turn the pages forward, not backward. If we did read it backward, the story would make no sense and confuse us. Having regretted is taking away the essence of life, because at the moment when the decision was made, it was exactly what you wanted. The decision was made for a particular reason. The great thing is that you may now see a different path of greater benefit. Using the knowledge for new experiences is the advantage successful people have over the masses. It is absolutely crucial to obtain knowledge from our experiences, but we should never be remorseful over past decisions. that helped shape our destiny. Residing in regret is like being stuck in a dark hole. When your mind is telling you there is no hope or means to get out. If you switch on a light bulb but cover it with a thick piece of material that makes the room dark, does that mean there is no light? No, the light is still there. It's just covered with we have the ability to take off the material at any time. Just think of that material as being your regretful mindset and the illusions that come along with it. Previous experiences that so many people allow to control their life are nothing more than a mental image. It is a story that we replay over and again, tormenting ourselves. But it is gone in reality. Take a look around. You are not physically in that moment that hurt you anymore, are you? Your memory of that experience is a figment of your imagination. So it means you have the power to change the way you think about it. It is now only in your mind. It is never the experience that is making you feel like you can't move on. It's your perception of the experience. No experience needs to be looked at in one set way. When you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. Max Planck. I can't think of anything worse than living in regret. It's true that we saved our life around those decisions. But in the same sense, we have the ability to shape our life around our current decisions. As long as you regret the decisions you have already made, the ends you must make will be sabotaged. In the process of eliminating regret, we must use forgiveness to conquer it. Forgiveness is one of the greatest gifts we have. It grants us permission to break free of burdens that restrict us from being at peace with ourselves. Resentment and remorse leave no room for growth. If we do not forgive ourselves, we will remain stagnant and hateful, and that will definitely affect what we create next in our lives. We must be at peace with our past in order to gain a full view of opportunities, to stop being restricted by narrow mind, and to allow for different decisions to be made in the future. There is no future in the past. Accept the pain, cherish the joys, resolve the regrets. Then can come the best of benedictions. If I had my life to live over again, I did do it all the same. Anand. It is essential that we accept our previous actions and those of others as an opportunity for growth. You may say sorry to someone, but don't expect their acceptance. Such an expectation could lead to constant disappointment. You must accept that you did your part. Apologizing to someone is not admitting that you did something wrong. It's allowing the other person and yourself to acknowledge that you know, see a better way. The most important thing you can do is forgive yourself. This will allow you to move on and make progress toward visions that you never trusted yourself to entertain. And if you think about a time when you have forgiven someone, was not it the case that you only truly came to forgive them once you forgive yourself for being in that situation that someone does to you cannot change, but how you see it can. So in order to forgive yourself and others, you must accept inwardly that it was your choice to be in that situation, to feel the way you did about it, to observe it the way you did, and to learn what you did from it. You can grieve the future if you are still holding on to the past. I once spoke to a woman who was raped as a young teen. The hatred she felt toward her attacker stopped her from excelling in life, especially in her relationships with other men. It was not until she found peace within herself that she was able to forgive him. She explained to me that through such an evil act, she found liberation within herself and began viewing the experience as one she could gain self-knowledge and strength from. Forgiveness is letting go of the hope that the past can be changed or perhaps been free. Self-forgiveness allows us to rebuild the faith in ourselves and those around us. It helps us realize that we are free from emotional restriction. We can once again portray real love. Forgiveness is truly a courageous act and helps liberate the soul. Without forgiveness and acceptance of the past, we remain crippled and unable to run. Failing to forgive will prevent us from ever gaining true happiness or fully respecting the great qualities that reign within us. Two major keys to real success: the deeper your scars, the more room there is to fill them up with love. Don't hate your scars, appreciate their depth. Free your mind, body, and soul. Task: write down the answers to these questions. What are the benefits of living in regret? Next question is, does it really make me feel better about myself to having resentment? What are the benefits of accepting my past decisions as an opportunity for growth? Can I gain knowledge from my past that will help shape my current decisions? What momentum can I build in my life if I make the decision to move forward and never look back? Using the empowering information and wisdom gained from my old experience, what can I now achieve in my future endeavor? Fifth, patience, a master quality. As you put into practice the qualities of patience, punctuality, sincerity, and solitude, you will have a better opinion of the world around you. Greenville, Greenser. Anyone who has created an extraordinary life will agree that patience is definitely at the top of the list. Without the constant use of this quality, it is impossible to create. If you follow a great achiever, someone who has a great relationship, or an individual who would be regarded as a wise mentor, you will see that patience is what keeps a fine line between sane and insane. It enhances the ability to clearly see what is around and make sense of a situation that we would otherwise get angry about or not properly assess. Without using this master quality, we will make irrational decisions that could have a detrimental effect on our life. In business, a lack of patience could influence us to make decisions that will adversely affect our goals. In relationships, it may cause unnecessary difficulties such as stress, lack of trust, or paranoia, which would then also result in the deterioration of our health. Impatience will attack every part of your life, especially when in pursuit of your vision. Some people get confused by the whole concept and think that taking action every day toward a vision is being impatient. I would just like to clear up that it is precisely the opposite. Lack of patience especially takes to its toll men on the road to achievement. Most people go for the quick dollar when impatience starts to take over, or settle for less than the bigger picture they have set up. You will notice that most really successful people struggle drastically at the beginning of their journey, yet they refuse to stop pursuing their goal. It was not about wealth right away. It was about getting themselves right first. We must build that inner strength initially. I can't tell you how many people have told me they attempted to do something they love, but said after a little while they went back to working a full-time job that they didn't enjoy just for the short-term satisfaction of having income. They get that money but are even more unproductive with it because they are not enjoying their life. A regular income can really benefit you, but not if it takes over your desired passion in life and is just an excuse to settle or give up. You will never be fulfilled that way. Some powerful achievers have had debts through the roof and been ejected from their houses because they could not pay the rent, but they never lost sight of their vision. That persistence always pays off. Stop comparing your journey with somebody else. Not all flowers blossoms at the same time. In my experience and through speaking to many about this topic, I have discovered that impatience is the main factor in what we call quitting. What we want seems so far away that it appears easier to stay where we are and just settle. This important question must then follow. Is it really easier living a life that is less than what you know you deserve? We will find everything and anything to do besides what we needs to do in order to get what we want. We will call multiple friends, think of 10 different movies to see, or go for another coffee. Anything to escape the fear that it's just too much to handle. Patience is a quality that should be put into practice every day with every situation. Every time I get impatient, I think back to the life I don't want to submit to, and it really nearly makes me physically sick. I then visualize my dream life and I am instantly powered and motivation to push forward. He then can have patience, can have as he will. Benjamin Franklin. I determined that no matter what life threw at me, I was going to do what I had to do. Training yourself to be patient is a great test of strength and something that needs to be done if you want success in any area. It starts in traffic, at work, and in your relationships with others. Don't forget, even holding on to trust until you find a win is a great strategy. We must make changes that will empower our life with patience, even in the simplest of scenarios. Change really can happen in an instant. We all know there have been some defining moments in our lives that have shaped our destiny, regardless of being a benefit or not. The decision to change can happen quickly and the results are acutely evident. At times, we are not satisfied until we see the end result of our decisions. The same goes for when we make the decision to practice patience in our daily lives. In business, for example, most will neglect to feed the quality of patience. They will wait to base their happiness on the end result. For example, the next monthly profits, what they don't realize is that it is made up of bitter decisions that cause the end result they desire to become reality. Look at nature, from the growth of a plant, which is result of a seed, to a collision of cloud, which results in a storm. There is a bitter and many small things that must take place before a massive result is seen. The calm before the storm. If we don't plant a seed and water it, how will it ever blossom? In one moment, you can decide that you want change and gather the inner. It is motivation in that instant that gets you started, but it is routine that makes it happen. Think back to the first time you went to the gym, for instance, because there are too much pain associated with not doing it and more pleasure in doing it. Something switched inside of you as time went on. You kept up the routine and it became a way of life. So yes, change does happen in an instant, but true results come from repetition, and that takes patience. How patience with all things, but chiefly have patience with yourself. Saint Francis de Sales. To master patience is to also have faith in yourself and your creator. I used to fall back on the idea that I know why this has all happened. This was my favorite saying to myself, the assurance of the greater plan I set for myself. You must build the belief that you know assuredly. You know the back of your hand that it's going to happen. We have all visualized the great life. Great life we aspire to. Although impatience plays a major role in stopping us from ever experiencing it, self-control and remaining strong in the face of impatience are the keys to winning. You are still going to get angry or impatient at times, but better your hardest not to vent it. Letting out anger is like facing a strong gust of wind and spitting directly in it. You affect yourself of the most. Use all the power, your focus, and you have, and focus on making an internal shift. Fight it. Overpower your limiting sides. Better your hardest not to vent it. You can when faced it with a challenging situation, use it to practice the art of patience. Once mastered, it will help you beat the next one with a little more ease. Before you know it, patience will be your subconscious reaction. Be quickly wizard in correcting yourself. Another great tool is to put things into a perspective. If you are waiting in traffic, just sit back and think about all those who don't even have food to eat, let alone a car to drive, and you will soon realize that your complaints are very petty. To cut above the rest, you must also use situations like these to your advantage. I have had so many people tell me that they don't have time to cover themselves and think about bettering their lives. And then I always refer back to the stuck in real life. I'm stuck in traffic situation. I'm not sure about you, but I see a lot of time in the day when you can really think finding the balance between persistence and patience is a pinnacle. When creating something great, this can only be achieved by constant practice. Without patience, Without patience, you are likely to give up. Patience can't be acquired overnight. It is just like building up a muscle. Every day, you need to work on it. Eknath Iswaran. 6. The quality of giving. What a gift. Gifty. Take a lit candle and light many others with it. Has the flame suffered and lost? What happens to flame when you put all those flames together? It gets bigger. It is the same principle in life. We should always seek to light the flame with an inner peace and self-love from within. Once that has been attained, you will be like a light in the world, ready to ignite anyone who crosses your path. People will feel your warmth. There is no greater gift than giving itself. It is one of the most beautiful compensations of life, that no man can sincerely try to help another without helping himself. Ralph Waldo Emerson. In the car one afternoon with a friend, another realization dawned on me. He let someone go in front of him and was waiting for a thank you wave. When he did not get it, He cursed himself for letting the guy in. It did hit me. Why expect a wave to determine how you feel about your great action? Question mark. When you recognize that your feelings should be determined by your own action, not someone else's reaction, your decision to give will not be for you any selfish desire of recognition or praise. It will be purely out of good intention, and that's giving. Things that are done out of pure intent are an amazing gift to all. It is evident that some people only give to obtain something in return. Is that really giving? Even if it is just a thank you that you expect, it takes away the true essence of the act. You should be proud of yourself, not proud of what others think and feel about you. If you can be really happy in giving, then it's already complete. If you want to be happy for anyone outside of you, be happy for them. Also take note that others' growth is your growth, and vice versa. Contribution is one of only three ways to ever be truly fulfilled. I have heard people say, "Oh, so I have to give money to charity." First, you don't have to do anything in life. Everything is a choice. Second is that what this world has made us believe, that the only gifts come in a box or a check. I know most people would not lose even a minute of sleep over kids half away across the world. I don't expect them to yet. We must rediscover and feed our true qualities first. Start with the people around you and begin with things that are basic. What about the gift of love, change or generosity in everyday life? How about the gifts of appreciation, acceptance, gratitude and communication? Why don't we give ourselves back the gift of life, which so many seems to forget? They are all free and help you and the people around you. They are far more important than a few checks a year. In saying that, helping a fellow human in need is the most fulfilling act we could ever perform. As we become more self-aware and the heart opens, we will notice the power we have to change someone's life. It will become like an addiction, something you will feel you cannot live without. It is more blessed to give them than to receive. Jesus Christ. A story that really inspired me and brought me to tears was one that I heard on the radio. It was about a wealthy man who went to Africa to visit a poor village. He met a young boy there who was 7 years old and dying of malnutrition. He said the boy's stomach was bloated, his hair was discolored, and he could hardly stand up. He knelt down and gave the boy an open coconut. He expected the child to eat it immediately, but to his amazement, the boy left the food by his side. The man walked off puzzled. A few minutes later, out of the corner of his eyes, he saw the boy pick up the coconut and walk to a tent. Without hesitation, he secretly followed. Pulling back the entrance to the tent, he saw the boy kneeling down, holding in one hand a baby and in the other the coconut. Tour guides later informed this wealthy man that the baby was the boy's dying brother. The young boy loved his baby brother so much that any bit of food he got, he fed the baby, going hungry himself. What a moving, touching and inspiring story of human bond. A boy so young, faced with death, is still able to surrender for human love. That really penetrated my soul. Just think of how many of us are blessed with so much, yet we give nothing. One man can save another man's life. That's what one man can do. There is no greater act than that. Happiness consists in giving and in serving others. Henri Dumont. We all have an amazing gift that was given to us. How many times have you had a gift wrapped up with your name on it and you did not open it? I'm guessing your answer will probably be never. Well, I have a rude awakening for some. The answer is every day. There is a God-given gift all wrapped up by the hate, despair, fear, complaining, and other limitations. be that consume our lives. We have the power to perceive things in a different light, and even more important, the power to change the way we act. Sadly, the vast majority of people believe that when they give, they are emptying themselves, or they are giving something up in the process. In order for them to feel significant, they unconsciously attempt to fill that gap with someone else's approval or praise. When it does not happen, they seem to be disappointed. In order to be happy in life, we must recognize that every time we give, we automatically receive. The feeling of giving is the gift. If you focus your energy on the great acts you commit to every day, you will experience fulfillment. Real success also thrives on the idea of giving. It helps you to create a stronger passion to not just follow achievement for yourself, but to better everyone around you. I could just imagine how lonely and unfulfilling life would be if I were to celebrate success on my own. That does not merely mean money, but to keeping the great qualities you know you have all to yourself. Share them. Allow people to see you for who you really are. Give of yourself, and it will come back tenfold. The energy we express with our thoughts, words, and actions is the real contribution to the world. It becomes contagious to those around you, because every soul is striving for that fulfillment. Before you know, it will feel not like a process, but rather like a way of life. Then the universe will be happy to welcome you to the never-ending cycle of self-growth. Gold with Graham. It takes a simple-minded man to linger around those who are praised, yet a courageous man to pick up those who have never fallen. We're walking in the heart of Melbourne. I pass a distressed-looking man sitting against a store front. Near him lay a beanie, a cup, and a dirty backpack. A knee up and head bent, he appeared to have given up all hope. I put some coins in his cup and continued on to do some shopping. As I walked back from the store, I decided to sit down on a chair across from him, watching people walk past, deliberately staying clear and acting as if he were an alien. I could not help but enter a state of compassion, thinking about what others would think if I sat next to him. I hesitated. This was the main street in the city, Bourke Street Mall. If you have ever been to Melbourne, Australia, you would understand what I am talking about. My love for this human was far too great to be held back by what others thought. So I left my fear behind and walked up. I finally realized that it was only when I cared that it seemed others did as well. When I stopped caring what they thought, it seemed they stopped caring too. I guess our mind really does create our reality. I knelt down, gave him $10 and said, "Do you mind if I have a chat with you, sir?" He looked up and said, "No." I sat right next to him in the same position he was in. It was an eye-opener to watch people walk past from down there. I then recognized that this man named Graham was disabled. His hands were deformed and he could hardly get the words out to speak. He murmured that the government had shut down his hospital. He had a volunteer who used to look after him, but they had also left. I might add, this gentleman was one of the nicest individuals I have ever met. He told me that the previous day he had been spat on and kicked in the face by someone who called him a retard. What amazed me was his attitude towards life. He said he would help those people if they needed his help, regardless of what they did to him. He even thanked God that he was shown manners as a child. He prays to God every morning and says thank you for being alive. He said that he knows God will watch over him and provide. He has not been let down yet and has taken his challenge as a way of life that he must deal with the best way he can. He understands that these people who ridicule him are only affecting themselves and battering their inner turmoil. As we continued to chat, I noticed he sat up and created more energy. I seemed to forget everyone as while talking, something wonderful happened. People began walking up and dropping money in his cup. Another man brought over food and people were smiling in our direction. I told him to smile back and he did. This one moment touched my heart and I will never forget it. Graham taught me the power of what one person can do. People will follow you, great act. This man has had so many challenges in his life, yet has such a positive outlook. He loves the people who beat him and has such strong faith. He assured me that he does not beg people, but has faith God will provide. He said whenever he starts to complain, he thinks of all the people who were kicked out of the hospital, who were far worse off than him. He is compassionate toward the human race and said his dream is for equality. What a golden moment in my life. If you can't feed a hunger 100 people, just feed one, Mother Teresa. 7. Understanding our body or ego. Appreciation, contribution and self-growth are the only ways to fulfillment. To embrace any one of these, we are required to put down our body of ego. Don't be ashamed of having an ego. It's human nature. But some people feed theirs so much that it gets in the way of really getting the most out of life. Ego is a great indicator of whether someone is genuine or not. An ego is like a seed that protects us from feeling embarrassed and prevents us from displaying who we really are. We believe if we put it down, others might think we are weird, which would alienate us. Someone with a big ego is generally hiding much deeper issues, and they are the people who are unfulfilled. They bear a mask their whole life, and when they feel they are about to be exposed, they lash out and attack your actions, rarely looking at their own. They fear meeting a stranger underneath the mask. They are the same people who usually look at how much they can take rather than what they can give. They are commonly self-centered. Their intentions are frequently ill, and their desires are far from contributing. The sad thing is that even though most people are aware of this fact, but they still display their ego. We must learn to direct our ego in a way that actually benefits the world and ourselves. Being human, I still find myself being caught up in ego at times, yet my self-awareness pulls me back into line almost instantly. So if you think you are too cool for school, think again. No one escapes the classroom of life. Humbly embrace its knowledge or feel its punishment. Putting down our ego is crucial, not just for lasting happiness, but also for achievements. Self-growth requires us to listen and obtain knowledge from people, which requires that our ego be put aside. Ego is the number one factor that prevents us from listening, with its attitude that we don't need help and we can do on our own. I was out for coffee with a property investor one afternoon, and he told me a story that Sir Bob Geldof had shared at a seminar. Jadoff was telling them about this chubby little kid who would always be hanging around and asking for advice. He later mentioned that he never knew that same kid would grow up to be Bono from U2. Another great story is that Michael Dell, the creator of Dell computers, he had his first job working in a Chinese restaurant for $2.3 an hour. He would go in early and humble himself by listening to the wise owner speak about his passion and love for the business. Taking the advice of others and always being willing to take in new information is vital to success. Your ego must be down in order for you to listen to the advice your spirit gives you every day. If you have a stubborn mindset that is stuck in one position, you will never be fulfilled. Your spirit is by far your best teacher and guide, as it knows all the answers to your questions. That deep voice inside knows what's best and will bump you initially. If something does not feel right, how many times has your gut feeling been right? How many times have you convinced yourself otherwise and been unhappy? It's usually our mind that gets in the way of listening to our spirit. The key to aligning them both is separating yourself from your ego. When you unify the power of your thoughts and with that wise inner voice, your success is self-evident. If you still feel empty in your life, it is because you have yet to surrender your ego to humbleness. People will cross our path to help us grow in life, but it's our ego that stops us from noticing this and allows them to slip away. We don't like the way they look. We are judgmental, or we are not willing to hear what we know is the truth. Being humble throughout your experience is a true indicator of whether you are fulfilled or not. If you are not humble, you did better start being so, or you will never find fulfillment. Period. Confidence plays a major role in having an outstanding life, but makes you find the line between confident and cocky. It's a thin line, but you will be aware of which one you are sowing. Task: do not wait on until tomorrow. The qualities we just went through are extremely important to your growth and success. I want you to take them with you for now. The next section is on a different topic. So until tomorrow, focus on the qualities that drive success. Thank you very much for listening. This is the end of chapter 15 of the book and page number 207. Thank you very much.